recorded in the computer.
Okay. I share screen again. So Hare Krishna, thank you so much for joining this session, and thank you for giving this opportunity to serve the Srimad Bhagavata. So today's verse is a very beautiful verse. Sa esha atmavatam adishwaras trayimayo dharmamayas tapomaya gatayalikheir aja sankaradibir vitarkyalingo bhagavan prasidhata. So such a beautiful verse that Sukadeva Goswami is speaking about to the question that Parikshit Maharaj had asked at the beginning of this chapter. So it's always wonderful to serve the Bhagavatam, and an opportunity to either speak about the Bhagavatam or hear about the Bhagavatam is always pleasing, because this Bhagavatam is non-different from Krishna. We all know in Canto 1, Chapter 3, Text 43 is mentioned, Krishna Swadamo Upagate Dharmonyano Dhibisaha Kalo Nashta Drisha Esha Puranako Udino Udita. So the Srimad Bhagavatam is a scripture which is arisen after Krishna had wound up his pastimes in Dwapar. So after Krishna departed from this world, concluded his pastimes, wound up his pastimes in Dwapar Yuga, in place of Krishna, the Srimad Bhagavatam has arisen. So this Bhagavatam is actually non-different from Krishna. And when we get a chance to associate with Bhagavatam, it is so purifying, because we are directly associating with Krishna, either as a speaker or as a listener, doesn't matter. When we come in touch with Bhagavatam, it is so purifying. So this is why it's a very good opportunity for all of us, whether as a speaker or as a listener, to come in touch with the Bhagavatam. By the mercy of Srila Prabhupada, this literature is available to us in this form where we can read and absorb in a language which is understandable to all of us. How fortunate are we? How fortunate are we? We're so fortunate that this Bhagavatam can be read and understood in a language that all of us are familiar. 500 years ago, that was not the case. In Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he wanted to have access to one version of Chaitanya Charitamrita. He had to wait for 8 years. Today, this Bhagavatam is available to us. You go to any store, you purchase the Bhagavatam, and you can read. So that way, this entire sampradaya of Gaudiya Vaishnava sampradaya, for one to be connected to the sampradaya, we should be considered very, very fortunate. There is not one version of the Bhagavatam which is written with so much clarity. There is a word-to-word translation that Prabhupada is given. How much blood and sweat Prabhupada spent to actually present this knowledge to us. And how fortunate are we to be connected to this. So let's make use of this opportunity to get connected to the Bhagavatam, either in the form of hearing or in the form of reading or in the form of speaking. Whichever form we get connected to the Bhagavatam, it is very, very pleasing. So before I get to this verse, where Sukadeva Goswami explains about the supremacy of the Lord, and how the Lord is available to those who are above all pretensions, some context to this verse. How did this, why is it that Sukadeva Goswami is speaking this verse? If you understand the background of this verse, then probably we'll be able to appreciate this verse even more. The end of the first canto of the Bhagavatam, Parikshit Maharaj is asking Sukadeva Goswami a very, very important question. A question that all of us want an answer for. In fact, Parikshit Maharaj is asking Sukadeva Goswami two questions. He is asking Sukadeva Goswami, what is it that one should remember, chant, glorify, and do while living in this world? Is the first question. The second question is, how is it that one should quit this world? What is it that one should do when he leaves this body? So these are the two questions that Parikshit Maharaj is asking Sukadeva Goswami at the end of the first canto. Right? This is when Sukadeva Goswami is coming to the assembly where all the sages are present, and where Parikshit Maharaj is present, and Sukadeva Goswami is about to present the Srimad Bhagavatam. Parikshit Maharaj is asking this question. And the beginning of the second canto, the canto that we are currently seeing now, is an answer to that question. So that's why in the beginning of the second canto, Sukadev Goswami is answering both of these questions to Parikshit Maharaj in just two verses. So if you go to Canto 2, Chapter 1, Text 5. So this is the answer to the first question. Tasmad Bharata Sarvatma Bhagavan Ishwaro Harihi Srotavya Kirtavyascha Smaratavyascha Chechatabhyam. So what is it that one should think? What is it that one should glorify? What is it that one should always remember? Sukadev Goswami is explaining, oh descendant of King Bharata, one who desires to be free from all miseries must hear about, glorify, and also remember the personality of Godhead, who is the super soul, the controller and the savior from all miseries. So this is the instruction that Sukadev Goswami is giving to Parikshit Maharaj. So he explains how one should lead his life. So even while leading one's life, one should every tasmad bharata sarvatma, all living entities, what should they do? They should glorify. They should remember whom? The personality of God, who is the super soul. In fact, that very word super soul is used in the same verse that we're discussing today. So this is what Sukadev Goswami is advising Parikshit Maharaj how one should lead his life. Then in the next verse, he is telling Parikshit Maharaj how one should leave this body. Etavan sankhya yogabhyam swadharma parinishthaya janmalabe parepumsho ante narayana smriti. The highest perfection of human life achieved either by complete knowledge of matter and spirit, by practice of mystic powers, or by perfect discharge of occupational duty is to remember the personality of God at the end of life. So in two verses, Sukadev Goswami is clarifying to Parikshit Maharaj, what is the art of living? What is the art of leaving? So all of us are inquisitive to know this, right? How do I lead my life? And how should I leave this body? So in these two verses, Sukadev Goswami is clarifying both of these aspects to Parikshit Maharaj. He is establishing remembrance of Krishna, remembrance of Narayan as the supreme occupational duty of the human being. So very clearly, the Bhagavatam establishes bhakti as the supermost goal. But after speaking this to Parikshit Maharaj, because in the assembly, there are also some yogis who are present, Sukadev Goswami briefly talks to Parikshit Maharaj about Ashtanga Yoga. He talks about two levels of Ashtanga Yoga. He talks about how a neophyte yogi can advance himself from his current position to come to the platform of bhakti. And he also talks about how an advanced yogi can make further progress. So because Ashtanga yogis are also present, and to give them satisfaction, Sukadev Goswami also explains the path of Ashtanga Yoga in two different sections. Ashtanga Yoga, which can be practiced by a neophyte devotee, a neophyte Ashtanga Yogi, and then an advanced Ashtanga Yogi. How is it that he can also gradually, stage by stage, come to the platform of understanding the world? But while explaining this, Sukadev Goswami very clearly clarifies to Parikshit Maharaj that this process of Ashtanga Yoga that I've explained is very difficult to follow. Because for a neophyte Ashtanga Yogi, Sukadev Goswami explains the meditation on the Virat Rupa of the Lord. Understanding this world, entire world, as an expansion of the Lord and then meditating on that. And for an advanced yogi, Sukadev Goswami explains the different steps that one should follow to gradually come to the platform of Samadhi. But Sukadev Goswami says that the practice of Ashtanga Yoga is not very easy, it's difficult. And so in the second chapter of the second canto of the Bhagavatam, Sukadev Goswami again concludes the importance of bhakti. So there are two slokas where he concludes the importance of bhakti. So in 2233, Sukadev Goswami says, Nahi ato nya sivapantha vishata samsmata iha vasudeve bhagavati bhakti yogo yatto bhavet. So he says here, for those who are wandering in the material universe, there is no more auspicious means of deliverance than what is aimed at in the direct devotional service of Lord Krishna. So here again, in the second chapter, after explaining the process of Ashtanga Yoga, in the second chapter of the second canto, Sukadeva Goswami once again reiterates the importance of why bhakti is important. Not only that, in the next verse, 2:34, he also explains that this process is being understood by Brahma also. Bhagavan Brahma Parshyena Trid Anvikshya Manishaya Tad Adhyas Vayasat Kutasto Ratiratman Yatovabhi. The great personality Brahma, with great attention and concentration of the mind, studied the Vedas 3 times. And after scrutinizingly examining them, he ascertained that attraction for the Supreme Personality of Godhead Sri Krishna is the highest perfection of religion, you see. So even Lord Brahma was scrutinizingly studying the Vedas. How many times? 3 times. But even after studying the Vedas for 3 times, Lord Brahma was very clear. He clearly ascertained that attraction for the personality of Godhead. That adasyava kutosta ratiratman yato bhavete. That attraction, atman, atmani means attraction. That attraction for Sri Krishna is the highest perfection of religion. You see? So, Sukadeva Goswami is not only giving his view, he is also giving Brahma's opinion on this. And Brahma came to this opinion not by studying the Vedas 1 time, but by studying the Vedas 3 times, he could clearly ascertain that bhakti is the topmost platform. That's why this Bhagavatam, throughout, it talks about bhakti. Bhakti is the highest principle that is explained in the Bhagavatam. Savai kumso paro dharmo yato bhakti adoksaje ahitukya pratyata yayatmasu prasita. So, after speaking this in the second chapter of the second canto, in the third chapter of the second canto, Sukadeva Goswami explains to Parikshit Maharaj that this process of bhakti can be taken by anyone. Whether one has desires, one has no desires, in whichever platform one functions, one can take this process of bhakti. So Sukadeva Goswami says, akama sarva kamo va moksha kama udharadi tivrena bhakti yokena yajate purusha. A person who has broader intelligence, whether he be full of material desire, whether he is a kami, whether without any physical desire, either he doesn't have, he's a jnani, he doesn't desire material, but he wants to become one with the Lord, or desiring liberation, he's a mukta kami, must by all means worship the Supreme Whole, the personality. So, this is the statement that Sukadeva Goswami makes to Parikshit Maharaj in the third chapter of the second canto. After hearing this, Parikshit Maharaj is convinced that hearing about Krishna, hearing about the activities of Krishna, hearing about the pastimes of Krishna is the supermost duty of a human being. He is clearly convinced about the explanations given by Sukadeva Goswami. And that is why in the beginning of the fourth chapter, the chapter that we are seeing now, Parikshit Maharaj wants to understand more about the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And when he wants to understand more about the Supreme Personality of Godhead, his intent is to develop devotion to the Lord. Because he's very clearly understood from Sukadeva Goswami that developing devotion to the Lord is a supreme occupation, is the supreme result that he can obtain by hearing the Bhagavatam for 7 days. So, which is why Parikshit Maharaj is questioning Sukadeva Goswami in the beginning of the fourth chapter, that I want to know about the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But when one wants to know about the Supreme Personality of Godhead and one wants to practice bhakti to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one has to approach it in a systematic manner. Parikshit Maharaj is not asking Sukadeva Goswami, you tell me the pastimes of Krishna, no. He's telling him, tell me about the supreme energy of the Lord. Tell me how the Lord creates this world. How does this process of creation happen? Because only when I understand how great the Lord is, how glorified the Lord is, only then I can give my heart to the Lord. That's why the Bhagavatam is a systematic presentation of the glories of the Lord. Sukadeva Goswami could have, Parikshit Maharaj could have directly asked, you tell me about, the 10th canto of the Bhagavatam, the pastimes of the Lord. No. He first wants to know the greatness of the Lord. just like even in our normal lives, when we want to love someone, we have to know how good that person is, right? We have to know how great that person is. Unless we know, we don't know how great that person is, how can we give our love to that person? So the same sentiment is shared by Parikshit Maharaj. That is why Parikshit Maharaj is first asking Sudeva Goswami, you tell me about the energies of the Lord. How does the Lord create this world? So that is why the fourth chapter is entitled The Process of Creation. And Sukadeva Goswami starts explaining the process of creation to Parikshit Maharaj. But before he explains the process of creation, he glorifies the Lord. He seeks the blessings of the Lord. See, one cannot speak anything about the Lord without the blessings of the Lord. Without the mercy of the Lord, one cannot glorify the Lord himself. Like Brahmaji himself mentions this. If I have to glorify the Lord, then it's only by the mercy of the Lord that I can glorify. So, Sukadeva Goswami is following the same footsteps. Before he starts explaining the process of creation, in these verses, he is glorifying the Lord. So, this particular verse that we are seeing is one such glorification. So that's why the Bhagavatam, if you see, it starts with creation. In fact, there are 10 subject matters which are discussed in the Bhagavatam. And this is explained in the 10th chapter of the second canto. Artho sarga visargascha sthanam poshanam utayaha manmantara ishanukataha nirodha mukhya ashraya. These are the 10 subject matters of the Bhagavatam. So if you see this 10 subject matters of Bhagavatam, Sukadeva Goswami said in the Srimad Bhagavatam, there are 10 divisions of statements regarding the following. The creation of the universe, sub-creation, planetary systems, protection by the Lord, the creative impetus, the change of the Manus, the signs of God, returning home back to God, liberation and the Samambhavam. So all these 10 subject matters are discussed in the Bhagavatam. It starts with explaining the process of creation. So what Sukadeva Goswami is going to explain to Parikshit Maharaj as part of chapter 4 is going to be the creation of this universe. And before explaining the creation of the universe, he is making the statement. In fact, the creation of the universe is explained in both the second canto as well as in the third canto. The third canto, when Maitreya Muni and Uddhava, they have a conversation. Maitreya Muni and Vidura, sorry. When Maitreya and Vidura have a conversation, there also the process of creation is explained. So in two places, the creative impetus, the creation of the Lord is mentioned in the Bhagavad. So this is just to give you a context of in what mood is Sukadeva Goswami speaking this verse. So sometimes when we understand the context and we understand the mood, we'll be able to appreciate this verse. So now coming to this verse, Sukadeva Goswami is telling Parikshit Maharaj, oh Lord, you are the super soul and the supreme Lord of all self-realizers. He says he's the personification of the Vedas, religious scriptures and austerities. He is worshipped by Lord Brahma and Shiva and all those who are transcendental to all pretensions. Being so revered with awe and veneration, may that supreme absolute be pleased with me. So Sukadeva Goswami wants to please the Lord. You see, may that supreme absolute be pleased with me. And in the purport, Srila Prabhupada particularly emphasizes on this aspect related to pretension. So what Srila Prabhupada explains, and we'll go into greater details as we talk more about this particular verse. This word called pretension. So what Prabhupada explains is, one can actually approach the Lord. One can actually render devotional service to the Lord when he is transcendental to all pretensions. And Prabhupada explains what this pretension means. See, the first part of this verse, that the Lord is the super soul and the supreme Lord of all self-realized souls, this all we know. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Ishvara sarva bhutanam hrideshu arjana tisthati pramayan sarva bhutan yantra rudani maya. I am present in the heart of every living entity. I am the super soul. Even in the verse that we saw in the second canto, first chapter, that also explained how the Lord is a super soul. And we all know that in the first canto itself, Krishna is established as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Ete chamsa kalam pumsham krishnastu bhagavan soyam indriyadi vyakulam lokam hridayanti hridaye. So In every yuga, there are so many incarnations, but among all those incarnations, Krishna is established as the supermost, the supreme personality of Mridayanti Yuga. In every, irrespective of how many incarnations the Lord takes, all of these incarnations flow from Krishna. So that fact has already been established. It has also been established that he is the personification of the Vedas, religious scriptures and austerities. Because we just read a verse where Lord Brahma, even after reading the Vedas three times, he comes to the conclusion that attraction to Krishna is the supermost conclusion of the Vedas. We also know the verse from the Bhagavad Gita, Sarvasya chaham hridi sannivishta matasmati jnanam apohanam cha vedeshtu sarvera ahameva vedyo vedantakrit vedavit eva chaham. In that verse, it is very clearly explained that 15th chapter, 15th verse, is very clearly explained that Krishna is a summum bonum, the conclusion of all interpretation of the Vedas. So all these things have been beautifully explained. So which is why Prabhupada particularly lays emphasis on this word called pretension. And what does pretension mean? And why is a devotee above all pretension? So the entire purport is almost dedicated to this particular phrase. So let's start analyzing this a lot deeper in line with what Srila Prabhupada has mentioned in the purport. A devotee of the Lord, Prabhupada says, is above all pretensions. And the reason he is above all pretensions is because all of the other practitioners of religion, they are all after satisfying themselves. So there are three categories of people that is mentioned. So one is called a bhukti kami. Then you have somebody called mukti kami. And then finally you have siddha kami. So the bhukti kamis are basically people who do rituals, who do Vedic rituals, but their end goal of this bhukti kami is basically to enjoy material sense gratification. So while a bhukti kami, mukti kami and siddhi kami, these three categories of people are all trying to worship the Lord, still they are classified to be pretentious. The reason they are classified to be pretentious is because their intent is to satisfy themselves. They want to satisfy, they want their goals to be satisfied. They want personal sense gratification. They are approaching the Lord not to satisfy the Lord, but to satisfy themselves. That's why they are classified to be pretentious. So a bhukti kami does a lot of Vedic rituals, but the end goal of a bhukti kami is, with all these rituals, I should enjoy material sense gratification. I should satisfy my body. That is how a bhukti kami is. Now, so we may think, what is wrong with a mukti kami? A mukti kami is seeking liberation. So what is wrong with the mukti kami? The mukti kami, as Prabhupada explains, is also desiring to become one with the Lord. See, when Sukadeva Goswami is explaining this process of Ashtanga Yoga, there are stages in Ashtanga Yoga, right? There is Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, Dharana, Dhyana, and then there is finally Samadhi. So there are eight steps involved in the process of yoga. So the last step is called Samadhi. Now the Mukti Kami, when he is practicing these different stages, his aim is to become one with the Lord. The Mukti Kami wants to become one with the Lord. He wants to merge with the Lord, which means he wants to become as good as God. So Prabhupada explains that this is not a very high platform because you still want to become equal to God, which means you're desiring to become God, which means this is also on the material platform. This is not completely spiritual. So that's why the mukti kamis, though they desire liberation, they are also classified as pretentious because their love for the Lord is not unadulterated. There is some adulteration. It is not unconditional. There are some conditions. So that's why the mukti kami are also classified as pretentious. Now let's look at the third one, the Siddhi Kamis. So we talked about Bhukti Kami, why they are pretentious. Then we talked about Mukti Kami in terms of why they are pretentious. The third classification of the Siddhi Kamis. Why are the Siddhi Kamis pretentious? Because the Siddhi Kamis, they also want to attain yogic perfections. So the practice of mystic yoga, they want to attain the 8 kinds of perfections that is possible for a mystic yogi, which is explained in the purport. Becoming heavier than the heaviest, lighter than the lightest, taking control of situations, becoming somebody who can fly. So these are different characteristics that a Siddhi Kami can attain. But a Siddhi Kami is interested in these perfections. He is not interested in attaining the lotus feet of the Lord, serving the Lord, pleasing the Lord. Now, these are not things where Siddhi Kami is interested. A Siddhi Kami is also interested only in attaining perfection in his yoga practice. Oh, I want to become somebody who can practice all these Ashtasiddhis. So that is why this particular verse from the Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is in the Madhya Leela, Krishna Bhakta Nishkama Ata Eva Shanta Bhukti Mukti Siddhi Kami Sakalyashana. So this particular verse comes in the 19th chapter of Madhya Leela, and this is a conversation that happens between Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Rupa Goswami. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is coming back from Jagannath Puri, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is coming back from Vrindavan going to Jagannath Puri, he meets Rupa Goswami in Prayag. And at that time, this conversation happens between Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Rupa Goswami. So there, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explains, Krishna Bhakta Nishkama Ateva Shanta Bhukti Mukti Siddhi Kami Satyash. So this Bhukti Kamis, Mukti Kamis, Siddhi Kamis, all these three people, finally they are Kamis. The reason they are called Kamis is because they are interested in their personal sense gratification. And that is why Sakali Ashanta, they are unhappy. They are not peaceful. Why they are unhappy and why they are not peaceful? Because they want more and more. Like for example, if you take a Bhukti Kami, a person who is a Karmi, who is working hard day and night, he, even if he earns millions of dollars, he wants more. He wants to earn more. And the more he earns, he feels more and more satisfied. So that's why a Bhukti Kami, a person who is seeking sense gratification, he's not satisfied. Even if he reaches a particular level, he still wants more. Oh, how can I get more? That's how a Bhukti Kami is thinking. So a Bhukti Kami is not satisfied. If you take a Mukti Kami, even if the Mukti Kami becomes one with the Lord, he merges the existence of the Lord. Even in that state, he is not happy. He is not happy in that state. Because there is no activity. In the Brahma Jyoti, there is no activity. So he also has a tendency to fall down. Even we have seen, right, a lot of impersonals, a lot of people who take up the renounced order of life, that they are not able to perform, they are not able to get their desires satisfied, they start doing some philanthropic work, right? And they again come down to the material platform. So a Mukti Kami also doesn't get satisfied. He is also Ashanta. And a Siddhi Kami is also not satisfied, because in spite of obtaining so much perfections in by practice of mystic yoga, he wants to attain more and more. He is not happy. So that's why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Bhukti Mukti Siddhi Kami Shakalashanta. If you read the purport of this particular verse, the Madhya Leela 19.149, Prabhupada very beautifully explains why a Bhukti Kami, a Mukti Kami and a Siddhi Kami are unhappy. So I just kind of condensed it for you. But these are the reasons why all these three classifications, all these three categories of practitioners of religious principles are unhappy. But the Krishna Bhakta, the person who renders devotional service to the Lord, is happy. He's very happy. Why? Because he's Nishkama. His only intent is not to please himself, but to please the Lord. He is only trying to please the Lord. his whole intent or whole purpose is to somehow please the Lord. That's all. By devotional service, he wants to please the Lord. And in this process of pleasing the Lord, a devotee is not worried about himself. He knows that the Lord will take care of him. He knows the Lord. The thinking, the way a devotee thinks is that I am a part and parcel of God. So this verse in the Bhagavad Gita, this is how a devotee thinks. He functions in the spirit. Mama yamsa jiva loke jiva bhuta sanatanaha manashastrani indriyani prakriti stani karshati. The living entities in this conditional world are my eternal fragmental parts. Due to conditional life, they are struggling very hard with the six senses of equal domain. So a devotee functions with this understanding that I am a part and parcel of God. And being a part and parcel of Krishna, my duty is to engage in the loving service of the Lord. So when a devotee functions in this particular mood, he is not disturbed by any desire. Because he knows that the Lord will protect me under all circumstances. Kaunteha pratijanati name bhakta pranashyati. In every circumstance, Krishna makes a promise to Arjuna in the Bhagavad Gita. That Arjuna, I promise you that my devotee will never perish. So this understanding a devotee has. A devotee has a very firm understanding that Krishna will protect me under all circumstances. Avashyashe vishwasu. Avashyashe vishwaso rakshito phalam. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur says this. When there is a need, the Lord will protect me. Even in the six principles of surrender, I think that Prahlad Prabhu was explaining this last week. Anukulyesha sankalpa, pratikulyesha varjana, rakshashyati vishwaso, gotriptra varanam tata, atmanikshepam, karpanya sadvidhi sharanagati. The six principles of bhakti, rakshashyati vishwaso. The third principle is, oh, my Lord will protect me under all circumstances. So this is how a devotee is thinking. And because a devotee thinks this way, he is protected under all circumstances, which is why a devotee is shanta, he is peaceful. Krishna explains in this verse, right, in the Bhagavad Gita, 5:29, why a devotee is peaceful? Bhoktaram yajna tapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram suhridam sarvabhutanam jnatvamam shantim richati. The sage is knowing me as the ultimate purpose of all sacrifice and austerities, the supreme lord of all planets and demigods, and the benefactor and well-wisher of all living entities, attain peace from the pangs of material miseries. So a devotee is actually peaceful because he has understood three things. Prabhupada explains this. He understood three things. What are the three things he has understood? Bhoktaram yajna tapasam. The real enjoyer is not me. The Bhuktikami, this Bhuktikami and the Siddhikami, all these three classifications of people, they are all thinking they are the enjoyer. Whereas a devotee's understanding is very clear. He knows that I am not the enjoyer. Bhoktaram yajna tapasam. It is Krishna who is the enjoyer. Sarva Loka Maheshwaram. Wow, he is the supreme proprietor of all that being. And Suhridam Sarva Bhutanam. Oh, he is the well-wisher of all living entities. With this understanding, when a devotee functions, Nyatva Mam Shantim Richati, he is peaceful always. You see how different a devotee's understanding is as compared to all the three other classifications. This is why a devotee is peaceful. A devotee is peaceful because he knows that I am not the enjoyer. I am a part and parcel of Krishna and my duty is to serve Krishna. This is the understanding. So a devotee functioning on this platform attains peace and is different from all the other three classifications. So that is why Srila Prabhupada in this purport explains that the devotees are non-pretentious. They are not pretentious people because their only objective is to satisfy the Lord. Which is why even Sukadeva Goswami in this particular verse, he says, being so revered with awe and veneration, may that supreme absolute be pleased with me. So Sukadeva Goswami is also praying the reason I'm doing all of this, the reason I'm speaking this Bhagavatam, the reason I'm glorifying the Lord is not for my personal sense gratification. No, it is because that the Lord will be pleased with me. So this explains the mood of Sukadeva Goswami. Why Sukadeva Goswami is a devotee, this by itself explains. He is neither a Bhuktikami, Muktikami or a Siddhikami. He is a Bhakta. And how do we know he is a Bhakta? Because his intent is to please the Lord. His intent is to please the Lord. So, this is the topmost position of a devotee. That's why coming to this platform of becoming a devotee is not so easy. I think it's explained in this verse of the Bhagavatam. I think it's 14, 15, 4. I don't know if it's the right. Muktanam apisiddhanam narayana parayanah sudurlabha prasannatma kotishvapi mahamune. Oh great sage, among many millions who are liberated and perfect in knowledge of liberation, one may be a devotee of Lord Narayana Krishna. Such devotees who are fully peaceful are extremely rare. He sudurlabha prasannatma. Sudurlabha prasannatma. So the real prasannatma, or the real person who's happy, is actually a devotee. And here it is explained that such a devotee who is peaceful are extremely rare. So only a devotee can actually be peaceful. None of the other categories of people who are trying to follow religious practices can actually be peaceful. And that is why, and the reason they can be peaceful is because they are not pretentious. The other categories are pretentious, because the devotees are not pretentious. Actually, that's why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he explains to Rupa Goswami, he further explains, Brahmanda Brahmite Kona Bhagyavan Jeev, Guru Krishna Kripa Bino Bhakti Rakamish. Who is that person who is fortunate? Who can actually get the seed of bhakti? We get the seed of bhakti, we are most fortunate, because actually only a bhakta is a prasannatma. We saw that in the Bhagavad Gita, in chapter 5, text 29, here again, in the Bhagavatam, the 6th canto, chapter 14, text 5, the same thing is explained as to why sudurlabha prasannatma, a devotee is always peaceful. So, we get back to this verse. In the interest of time, So, this is the conclusion that we can understand from this verse in terms of how a devotee can function in a manner which is pretentious, not pretentious, and how the Lord is satisfied with this. But before we conclude, I'll tell you a nice pastime in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, which beautifully explains how devotion can actually be obtained only by one who is not pretentious. So, in the Antya Leela, in the 5th chapter of the Antya Leela, the Chaitanya Charitamrita narrates the pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the last 18 years of his stay in Jagannath Puri. So in that, the fifth chapter is actually about the conversation between Ramananda Rai and Pradyumna Mishra. It's a very beautiful conversation. But as part of that chapter, there is this very nice pastime of a Bengali poet. Sometimes understanding how is it by being pretentious you cannot attain the Lord through a pastime, you know, will help us get this a lot more deeper into our consciousness. So this Bengali poet, there was a Bengali poet in Jagannath Puri. And this Bengali poet in Jagannath Puri, he used to compose very beautiful verses. So there was this devotee called Bhagavan Acharya who was staying in Jagannath Puri. And he knew this Bengali poet. So this Bengali poet, one day he came and he presented a very nice poem to Bhagavan Acharya. This poem was composed in glorification of Lord Jagannath and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was also staying in Jagannath Puri. Now, when he came to Bhagavan Acharya and he presented this poem, Bhagavan Acharya liked that poem. And there were a lot of devotees who were sitting in his house. And they were also, when they were hearing to this poem, they were also very appreciative of him. Oh, it's nice, very beautifully written about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Jagannath, he's related them so very beautifully. Very nice poet. But this Bengali poet is not a devotee of the Lord. He's just some good writer. He could write some poem, that's all. But he was thinking, this Bengali poet was thinking, because I'm a poet, you know, I can write anything. I have the caliber to appreciate Jagannath and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Bhagavan Acharya, in Jagannath Puri, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was personally present, any poem or any literature that is written by anybody in glorification of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, before it was presented to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, it had to be authorized by Swarup Damodar Goswami. So Swarup Damodar Goswami, all of you might know, was the personal secretary of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. In fact, in the Gaur Ganadesh Deepika, it is said that Swarup Damodar Goswami was actually a Lalita Shati. So he incarnated as Swarup Damodar Goswami. And as we know, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu comes with Radha Bhav. He is Radha Bhava Duti Swalitam Naomi Krishna Swarupam. So anything that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had to read about his, first of all, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu never liked being glorified. But even if there's something that was glorified about the Lord, or about his relationship with the Lord, it first had to be vetted by Swarup Damodar. Even when Rupa Goswami, he compiled his Lalita, Vidagdha Madhava and Lalita Madhava, that was also personally ratified by Swarup Damodar Goswami and even Ramandarai before everybody accepted it to be authentic. So this Bengali poet wanted to influence Bhagavan Acharya to convince Swarup Damodar Goswami that this poem should be presented to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Bhagavan Acharya went and met Swarup Damodar Goswami. And he wanted to convince Swarup Damodar Goswami that you should read this poem. This poem is so beautiful. He's written it in glorification of Lord Jagannath and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And you should read this. Swarup Damodar Goswami he didn't like the idea because he knew that this Bengali poet was not a devotee of the Lord. So he told Bhagavan Acharya, see, you're getting vitiated. You're getting pulled by all these different commentaries by people who are not on the platform of devotion, who are pretentious. So they will not be able to understand the depth of Chaitanya's Leela or the Leela of Lord Jagannath. So it is better that I don't hear these commentaries. But Bhagavan Acharya was very persistent. The reason Bhagavan Acharya was very persistent was because he was able to appreciate that poem. And also a group of devotees were associated with them. They also thought, oh, this poem is very beautiful. So for 3 days, Bhagavan Acharya tried convincing Swarup Damodar Goswami that somehow he should read this literature. Somehow he should read this poem. And finally, Swarup Damodar Goswami, because of the persistence of Bhagavan Acharya, he decided that, okay, you call him over. Let me hear out in terms of how he's composed this poem. Let me understand with what Baba has written. And then if it's appropriate, I'll present it before Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Bhagavan Acharya then invited this Bengali poet. This Bengali poet came. He met Swarup Damodar Goswami. And then Swarup Damodar Goswami told this Bengali poet, okay, I hear from Bhagavan Acharya that you've composed a very nice verse, right? A Bengali poem you've written. Talking about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Jagannath. Why don't you narrate this? So the Bengali poet, he started narrating this verse. It's in what he narrated. I'll try and see if I can pull that out. It's in Dantya Leela 5.1.3. CC. Yeah. Yeah, so this is the verse where Swarup Damodar Goswami is requesting him, kindly explain this verse, whatever you've compiled. And so he starts explaining this verse. So he says, the poet said, Lord Jagannath is a most beautiful body and Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is exceptionally great, is the owner of that body. So this is the explanation that the Bengali poet gave to Swarup Damodar Goswami. He said, Lord Jagannath is a very beautiful body, but Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is exceptionally great, is the owner of that body. Now, when Swarup, so when this explanation was given by the Bengali poet, all those who were present there, the other devotees, they all appreciated this. They said, "Oh, this is such a beautiful composition." He has explained Lord Jagannath to be of a beautiful body, and also Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the owner of that body. Wow, the sambandha that he has created between Lord Jagannath and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu looks exceptional. Very, very, they were all very pleased. But Swarup Damodar Goswami completely rejected this verse. The reason he rejected this verse was, he told the Bengali poet, "While you have tried to compose something in glorification of Lord Jagannath and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, what you have done is a grave offense, because you have composed, you have compared Lord Jagannath to a normal, person who has a body. You are saying Lord Jagannath is a beautiful body, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is owner of the body, which means you are saying Jagannath is body, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the spirit soul. Jagannath is not just the body. Jagannath is the Lord himself. So, by comparing Jagannath and Mahaprabhu to a material body and a spirit soul, you have committed a very, very grave offense." So, Swarup Damodar Goswami did not approve of this composition. He said this composition is completely false, because you are comparing two exalted personalities on the level of a jiva. So, if you see in the next verse, so this, he goes on with this composition. He says, "Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has appeared here in Neelachal to spiritualize the entire dull material world." So this is the further explanation that this poet gave. And then, hearing this, everyone present was greatly happy, but Swarup Damodar, who alone was very unhappy, began to speak in great anger. So what Swarup Damodar Goswami said, "You are a fool," he said. "You have brought ill fortune upon yourself, for you have no knowledge of the existence of the two lords, Jagannath Dev and Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, nor you have any faith in it." You see? So this is the explanation that Swarup Damodar Goswami gave to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then further he goes on explaining, he starts giving the real meaning of this verse. He says, "Lord Jagannath is completely spiritual and full of transcendental bliss, but you have compared him to a dull, destructible body composed of inert external jiva." So this is the rejection that Swarup Damodar Goswami gave to the poem composed by this Bengali poet. Now, this Bengali poet was not a devotee of the Lord. He was a poet. He knew how to compose verses. But he was artificially trying to take the role of being a devotee of the Lord, and trying to be pretentious. And which is why he was not able to please the Lord. That is why Swarup Damodar Goswami advises this Bengali poet on what his real duty should be. How is it that he should learn? Though Swarup Damodar Goswami chastised him for this composition, he also gave him instructions on what he should do to come to the platform of devotion. So here he says, "Tabeta panditya tomara hai ibe safala krishnera swarupa leela varniba nirmala." Only if you follow the principles of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his devotees will your learning be successful. Then you will be able to write about the transcendental pastimes of Krishna without material contamination. Which means, even to write a literature about Krishna is no joke. One can actually write a literature about Krishna. That's why even in our society of devotees, we don't usually encourage devotees to compose things on their own. We always follow this principle of quoting verses. Why do we quote verses? Because what has already been written has been written with the empowerment of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his devotees. Anything that we try to write out of our own accord, it will not be successful. So that's what Swarup Damodar Goswami is explaining. And he further goes on to explain, I'll not go through each of these verses. "You have composed this introductory verse to your great satisfaction, but the meaning you express is contaminated by offenses to Lord Jagannath and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu." So the series of verses after this, Swarup Damodar Goswami advises the Bengali poet how he can free himself from this contamination and come to the platform of devotion. free himself from all pretensions and become a devotee of Guru. So this is the pastime that I thought would be useful to narrate in the context of the shloka that we just covered today. So when we are free from all offenses, when we don't have the intent to satisfy our senses, then our false pretensions that we have, all of this gets managed. All of the pretensions that we have, either as a Bhuktikami, Siddhikami, Muktikami, or even otherwise, when we try to think that we are on the platform of devotion without actually being on the platform of devotion, these are all classified as pretensions. So when one comes to the platform of devotion to the Lord, there is no pretension, because the only intent of the devotee is to satisfy the Lord. Like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, na dhanam, na janam, na sundarim, tavitamba jagadisha kamaye, mama janmani janvishware, bhavatad bhakti rahita pradeya. The only purpose, Mahaprabhu says, that is existing is to serve the Lord birth after birth. Mahaprabhu has no other intention. He doesn't want mukti, he doesn't want liberation. Mama janmani janmish, it doesn't matter how many janmas I take, I want to serve. The same sentiment is expressed by Kulashekara Alvar also in the Mukunda Mala Stotra, in the second verse of the Mukunda Mala Stotra. Mukunda Murna Panipatya Yache Bhavantam Ekantam Idantam Artam Avas Mishishpas Charanar Vinde Bhave Bhave Yat Bhavat Prasad. So there also Kulashekara Alvar explains, I have only one yachakam, only one request. What is that request? Avasmishishpas Charanar Vinde, irrespective of how many lifetimes I take, Keshava, I only want to remember and serve you. So this is the mood of a devotee, and this is why a devotee is nishkama. A devotee is nishkama because his only intent is to serve the Lord, is to please the Lord. Just like how Sukadeva Goswami wants to please the Lord, a devotee always wants to please the Lord. In fact, Jiva Goswami, as part of this verse, he compares this phrase, Gata Vyalikair. It is mentioned in the purport. Prabhupada mentions this in the purport. Gata Vyalikair to Dharma Projita. This Gata Vyalikair, which is basically pretension, right? This Gata Vyalikair, but by those who are above all pretensions, is compared by Jiva Goswami to the second verse of the Bhagavatam. Dharma Projita Koitabha Hatro Paramo Niramat Saranam Satam Vedyam Vastu Vastu Sivadam Tapa Trayona Mulanam Srimad Bhagavate Mahamuni Krite Kimba Paradishvaraha Sadahridi Avrudyade Dakritibi Shushushu Vittarshana. So, in the second verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam, Dharma Projita Koitabha Hatro, where Shukadeva Goswami, or the author of the Srimad Bhagavatam, Vyasadev, he is rejecting all other processes of religion. So Jiva Goswami says that this Gata Vyalikair that you are seeing in this particular verse is compared to Dharma Projita, which is mentioned in the second verse of the Srimad Bhagavatam. The last element that is important before we conclude, Prabhupada explains why Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva are mentioned to be above all pretensions. And Prabhupada explains that because Brahma and Lord Shiva are part of the four Vaishnava Sampradayas, and because they are also devotees of the Lord, their names are mentioned to be transcendental to all pretensions. We also know that they are also Mahajans. In the sixth canto, it is mentioned, Swayambhu Shambhu Narada Kumaro Kapila Muni, the 12 Mahajans, Brahma and Lord Shiva are also mentioned. So that's the reason why Brahma and Shiva are also mentioned, particularly in this verse, to be transcendental to all pretensions. So that's the summum bonum of this particular verse. So the key takeaway for us is to understand that only a devotee is happy in all circumstances. A Bhuktikami, a Muktikami, and a Siddhikami, they are not, they are Ashanta. Krishna is a super soul and the Supreme Lord of all self-realized soul. So a devotee, his only interest is to please the Lord. And by pleasing the Lord, a devotee is satisfied. So this is the prayer by Sukadeva Goswami to the Lord before he starts narrating the process of creation. There are plenty other verse, plenty of other verses where Sukadeva Goswami continues to praise the Lord. This is one such verse. So I hope this is clear to all of you. Thank you so much for the opportunity provided. If there are any questions, happy to take it. If there's something that I'm unable to answer, I'll defer it to Prahlad Guru. Grantharad Srimad Bhagavatam TVI, Srila Prabhupada.
क्वेश्चन चैट बॉक्स पे वो
ओके एक्सिस हरे कृष्णा कैसे लाइक वॉक Hare Krishna Prabhu. So chanting Hare Krishna for material purposes, such as during a pandemic to release the suffering of the masses, comes under Bhakti Kama. No. So the objective. So when we chant Krishna's names, so that's why Sukadeva Goswami explains, right? One can come to this process. So while we doing some religious process, right, to get some material benefit. Yes, when you're doing some religious rituals, when you're doing rituals and the purpose of the rituals is to get some material benefit, it is on the platform of Bhakti Kama. But by chanting the holy name of the Lord, though initially the intent may be to satisfy material desires, by constantly chanting, the purification happens within the heart. And all of these material desires will get kicked off. That's why Sukadeva Goswami says, Akama sarva kama va moksha kama dare. Whether you are with desires, you don't have desires, no matter what, where you are, please come to this process. So even if initially it might sound like this bhakti kami, by gradually cleansing yourself, right, you will be able to come to the platform of bhakti. Just like how Dhruva Maharaj, when he worshipped Krishna, when he worshipped Narayana, his intent was what? His intent was to actually attain the position greater than Brahma. Stana abhilashi tapasi sitoham tam prapta deham ya munindra guya. So when Dhruva Maharaj was worshipping Narayana, his intent was to obtain a position greater than Brahma. But after he performed austerity, he understood that kachan vichinvan apidhiti ratnam. He said, I was coming looking for broken pieces of glass, and what I've got is diamond. So he said, Swamin Kritatmona Varam Nayachi, I don't want anything else. He said, I don't want anything else. I don't want anything else because I came looking for pieces of glass, but what I've got, is diamond. So initially, though Dhruva Maharaj also prayed to the Lord to attain a destination greater than Brahma, by the process of bhakti, his heart got cleansed and he came to the platform of pure devotion. So though we may start the process of chanting with some ulterior motives, with some desires, that is okay. We can still, by gradually developing the process of chanting, we'll come to the platform of pure devotion. I hope that answers the question. Any other questions anybody has? Thank you very much. This very beautiful interacting with all of you. Any questions feel free to ask, or later on you want to think, when Prahlad Prabhu can answer if there's anything else that you have. Thank you. Nice to know that you all found the session useful. It was useful for me also because it gives me an opportunity to concentrate your attention. Actually, this process of giving the class is a very good way of actually remembering the Lord. Because when we chant Krishna's names or when we hear something, our attention is not there full-fledged, right? But when you give a class, your attention will go nowhere. And I think anybody who gives a class will understand this. When you give a class, especially when you give a class, right, your attention is fixed on the subject. That's why this process of preaching is so beautiful. One of the reasons why Prabhupada explains that we should preach is because when we preach, our mind is fixed. It's completely in attention. I cannot think of something else and preach. Sometimes even chanting, we can do that. When you chant, you think of something else. Of course, that's not attention. Chanting with attention is what is recommended. But then it's difficult to bring the mind to attention when you're chanting or when you're hearing or when you're seeing the deity. But when you give a class, your mind is automatically absorbed. There is no way your mind can go this way. So that's why it's a good opportunity for all of us to actually preach. Because when we all preach, it gives us an opportunity to fix our attention on Krishna. So this 1 hour that we spend, at least as a speaker, my mind did not go anywhere. As a listener, your mind could have gone anywhere. But as a speaker, my mind was completely absorbed. So when all of us preach and when we constantly remember, our mind, you know, slowly we get to understand, we get firmly, at least for that, whatever hour we spend, our mind is in attention. And after that, you know, if there it goes, you never know. So thank you for the opportunity as well. If there are no other questions, we can conclude. Kirtaraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai, Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna.